We record it all together and kept the drums and bass. So the drums and bass were recorded live, and the guitars, we did scratch tracks, and then Luke and Kevin went back and redid all their guitars. So drums and bass, we did the whole song the first day, and then we redid some parts the second day, and then went right into guitars, and guitars took about 4.5 days. Lots of different tones and amps and parts.
Yeah, it's a massive amount of tracks that we've ended up with. But it's not like there's 190 things going on, different things going on at the same time. There are a lot of mics, you know, different kinds of mics placed in different spaces on one guitar track. So there's a lot of tonal options to mix together and stuff. Room atmosphere options on the drums and stuff.
I suppose for myself, since I knew there was going to be lots of work on the guitars, lots of attention to tone and really like taking each part kind of on its own terms. And that would mean that each section would be recorded separately for guitar. I decided to kind of make myself invisible to the recording process and not take any extra time for the bass. So the bass was just done at the same time as the drums. Nothing else was... No overdubs, no fixes. So I kind of enjoyed that part of it of like somewhat on principle just saying, okay, if we're going to take the guitar recording in this direction of being very, a lot of time and a lot of variation, I'll make the bass the opposite and have that just be recorded with the drums, forget about it, and then just deal with it in the mix.
It's very easy. Everything falls in place very easily. It's not like, nah, that doesn't work, that doesn't work. No, it's very, it seems like we're jamming like 5 days a week or something, but we see each other every 3 months or something, but it's very, yeah, it's easy. Yeah.
One thing I always loved about earlier death metal, you know, and even some of the earlier technical death metal and stuff is back in those days, you didn't have the luxury of Pro Tools and all this stuff that made it so easy and fast to edit. And so I think everybody in this band is old enough to kind of enjoy the rawness of those earlier recordings. And that's what we wanted to keep on this record too, was to capture as much of a live feel as possible and do as little editing as possible. Still being very detailed about tones and sounds and everything and takes, you know, we want to play as well as possible, you know.
It's the kind of thing where, like, if you come out of, let's say, a heavy, loud section and you're going into a soft section, there's a tendency a lot of the time to not switch dynamic and switch tempo right on a dime. There's a gray area where you might slow down a little bit or speed up a little bit and then slow down. And that's the kind of stuff that I really wanted to preserve in this recording. And just have it not be ruled by any kind of a synthetic time. So it did come out that way, and some tempos ended up being faster than we had originally planned or slower than we originally planned. But we just played it until we got something that sounded good and then said, that's the take.
I think on this one, there's even more of sort of like a, like energy to it because... like I said, we did this kind of in longer takes, you know?
We didn't use any click tracks. I think for the last album, we did maybe half the songs with, half the songs without, just depending on what felt right. So for this one, we did a full take of the song with everybody playing, and then for the parts that didn't have drums that were, for instance, like just one guitar or two guitars or something like that, I went back after the fact and built guide clicks for the scratch guitars based on the actual time that was played, so that the time is never steady. It's always following what we actually played. So in that sense, even the parts that had clicks weren't metronomic clicks. I think maybe except for like one riff where I did just an even tempo.
Some of it also ended up being, some of the parts, like some of the fast parts ended up being kind of played even faster than we were rehearsing them, just because the energy was there in the studio. And at first we were like, I don't know, maybe we should roll it back a bit, you know, and try another take. And after listening to it a couple of times, we were just like, no, it's got that spirit, you know, let's just let's keep that now, you know.
Most of the effects were done live as well. I mean, were done during the recording. So there's only a minimum of actual mix, reverb, or delay, or effects like that that I'm using. If we wanted delay or reverb on a guitar, we tracked it with a delay pedal or reverb pedal.
Honestly, like, I kind of let Colin, as an engineer, kind of tweak the knobs and stuff, because he knows how that's really going to sound when it's being recorded. Whereas, you know, for me, it's harder to tell. Yeah. Both Luke and I kind of let him play around with tones and pedals and stuff, and then go back and listen, like, do a kind of demo version of it, you know, just to get it, hear what it sounds like in the context of the rest of the music. And
that's something that I really like doing in recording, is actually just playing music as if it wasn't anything special. It's just you're playing the music, and then listen back to it and just decide if it sounds good. Doesn't matter if it's correct. Doesn't matter if it's the tempo that you decided it was going to be 2 years ago. If you played it and it's passionate and you listen back and it pleases your ear, then it's good.
Yeah, because we didn't really write, you know, too many additional parts that couldn't be done live, you know. There's a couple of harmonies on the solos that I can't do live, you know, single solos on the live, you know, because Luke will be playing the rhythm. But that kind of stuff, you know, I did that on Color Sans too, and I did it because it sounds cool, but like, if it's not there live, it doesn't make that much of a difference, really. So I did that a couple times in this record too, some harmonies here and there.
And since we were really going to be doing each guitar part, each section separately, it made sense to do that rather than, like, if we were going to record it live and then, you know, all together playing and then deal with sound later, maybe that would have been a way to approach it differently organically, like get actual live together takes, but then go back and reamp everything with different sounds or whatever later. Or just, even go direct and then do the sounds later. But since these guys knew they were going to be re-recording the guitars anyway, I was like, okay, good. Then that gives us an opportunity to just actually design each sound as it's recorded for guitar.
I really wish they're going to experience the record like, sit down with the headphones, close your eyes and go for a trip, you know, like watching a film or listening to a story. Because to me, it's a sonic painting, you know. That's really how I see this record. Those are like very specific, frames, you know, and you really go somewhere, you know.
I'm more or less mixing in sections, no matter how long the total piece is. So, even if it's a 1 minute grindcore song, if it has six different parts, I might make adjustments to each part separately, you know, subtle things like raising the snare 1 dB or something, or something more drastic like changing the panning of the guitar for one riff or something like that. So that's what I'm doing here as well. It just happens to be a song that lasts more than a half an hour. And that doesn't even change the ball game that much, because sometimes with bands I have one session per song, and other times I have all the songs in one session. If it's usually that works more effectively if it's a band where all the songs more or less sound the same and have the same instrumentation, or more likely, because most rock bands have the same instrumentation on every song, but if it's a band where they're going to add a zillion overdubs specific to each song, it kind of makes more sense to have it each song in its own session. If it's a band where like there isn't a ton of overdubs and it's pretty much the same sound the whole record, I can do all the songs in one session and then kind of have a nice overview of the entire record. As I'm mixing one song, I'm kind of mixing all the songs. So it can actually help the process go a lot faster. I don't have to like save settings, carry them over to another one. So I'm used to doing a whole album at once as well, so that's not that different.
Everybody's kind of on the same wavelength, you know, with this one. Willing to kind of actually like kind of let the music like be its own force and not overthink and doubt things so much sometimes. kind of trusting our initial gut reaction maybe a little bit more. Like,
that's what's wonderful about creation, you know. It's you don't really have to force thing or push thing. It just happens the right way.